Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Creativity, the Perfect Crime, written by Philippe Petit, read by Walter Dixon. A Forethought, Confession of an Outlaw. Make no mistake, I frown upon books about creativity. Too often they gather only formulas, point at Einstein and the Beatles, but rarely at the author, propose exercises that mistake the mind for a gym machine, and conclude each chapter with a recap worthy of fifth graders. In aiming at the universal, to satisfy the commonest denominator of human thinking and behavior, most of these books miss all of the originality, the humor, the serendipity, the grace, the exceptions to the rule, the idiosyncrasies that mold the way of art. So, if I don't believe in books about creativity, why am I writing one? Although the original idea for this audiobook was not mine, it came from the outside, its entire content comes directly from inside, from a life I have spent creating. I hope that my unconventional, insubordinate process of creativity will offer insight for anyone struggling to achieve his or her dreams. Born into the confines of rigid parenting, repressive schooling, and the narrow-mindedness of a country busy manufacturing 365 types of cheeses, quite early I started to rebel against authority. I was not very good at following. I had to distance myself from the norm, to venture along solitary paths, to teach myself. At 6, I taught myself magic. At 14, juggling. At 16, wire walking. In the process, I was thrown out of 5 different schools. Regardless, I would never have let my schooling get in the way of my education. Observation was my conduit to knowledge, intuition my source of power. I spent my days taking things apart and rebuilding them, not asking how to do something, but finding out. Hiding from people in order to stare at them, noting how they dress, talk, act, and noticing their mistakes. As a teenager, I spent considerable time at the circus and vaudeville theater, witnessing the best acts in the world, thereby setting my artistic standards at an unusually high level. I would compare the overall effect different performances had on me and decide who was the best dancer, the best ventriloquist, the best stand-up comic. I would try on their styles and attempt their routines. Ha ha! Yet trial and error provided results. All of this trying and failing, and watching and trying again, bred in me an arrogant, proud, and aggressive determination. Each discovery, no matter how naive, had to be jealously hidden from the rest of the world. Each victory felt like a stolen jewel. I fell into a natural state of intellectual self-defense. Let me explain. Always trying to be my best, I became guilty of pursuing perfection. Imagine that. Always working relentlessly, I became obstinate, and almost felt guilty about it. To protect what triggered my creativity, I became secretive. Anxious about being discovered, fearful of being caught, I ended up always on the lookout. At the outset of most projects, busy battling against overwhelming odds, I came to believe the entire world was against me. This was a reflection of reality as well as the frame of mind I needed to be at my most creative. It coated my character with an outlaw sheen. And I'm sure that with my constant sneaking, my tiptoeing, my way of approaching people inconspicuously from behind to spy on them or surprise them, I must have looked like a criminal, and certainly others must have felt I was one. And so I was not surprised the world around me reacted with suspicion and mistrust. Before I had reached 18, I had rewritten the book of ethics that had been forced on me earlier, and before I knew it, I had acquired the mind of a criminal. My attitude as an artist grew out of the realization I'd arrived at from an early age, that my intellectual engagement, my imaginative freedom, had a price, that of the forbidden. Whatever I decided to do, it was not allowed. Creativity is illegal, became my byword. The creator must be an outlaw. Not a criminal outlaw, but rather a poet who cultivates intellectual rebellion. The difference between a bank job and an illegal high-wire walk is paramount. The aerial crossing does not steal anything. It offers an ephemeral gift, one that delights and inspires. Despite my outlaw approach, or because of it, a network of personal creativity principles imperceptibly emerged. Lawlessness doesn't mean lack of method. In fact, the outlaw I became needed method all the more, because I was swimming alone to the island of my dreams. With the urgency of those who believe life is short, I found multiple ways of getting things done. I solved problems intuitively, and by refusing failure, I was able to achieve the impossible. I dedicated myself to my arts, bringing to bear a fanatic attention to detail and little respect for the established values of competition, money, or social status. For my first major high-wire walks, at Notre Dame, the Sydney Harbor Bridge, and the World Trade Center, oops, I forgot to ask permission, and after, I certainly did not seek forgiveness. Over the years, I went on refining a highly personal creative process. I kept drawing on my autodidactic elasticity, all the time knowing that I was never alone in my progress. Mentors, friends, and illustrious artists in a wide range of creative fields guided me and opened doors. They were masters of one craft, however, and I was a defiant Renaissance boy wanting to do it all. One day I was asked to share my creative process with others in the form of a lecture. I concocted a lively mixture of physical demonstrations, experiments with props, audience participation, storytelling, live drawings, quizzes, and even magic tricks, and I took pleasure in revealing some of my creative secrets. Word of my lectures spread, and I was encouraged to do more. My audience grew to be quite diverse. Aspiring wire walkers, Nobel Prize winners, clergymen, millionaires whose focus lacked focus, and businessmen striving to become millionaires, young entrepreneurs, people seeking a direction in life, curious souls, and students of all sorts of subjects. My audiences seemed to identify with my outlaw attitude, to be inspired by my propensity for venturing far off the beaten path. They asked me to elaborate on my grammar of creativity, and even the tech geeks I spoke to were hungry for more of this self-confessed Luddite's primer on self-teaching and self-discovery. Eventually, I distilled my audience's favorite topics into a one-man show, Wireless, Philippe Petit Down to Earth, and I began to see that despite my aversion to guides to the creative process, I really did have the makings of a book, but not a book about creativity, a book about my creativity. So think of this audiobook as a conspiracy, or, if you will, a manifesto, and think of yourself, dear listener, as an accomplice who is invited to explore your own field of intellectual or artistic crime. See this audiobook not as a blueprint for any specific crime, but as a series of postcards from the labyrinths I build to confuse those chasing me, the tunnels I dig to escape, the dams I erect to delay the invasion of the elements. Accept my invitation to become my student, my partner in crime. Together, we'll take chances and yet leave nothing to chance. We'll question the questions, yet arrive at definitive principles. We'll be stubbornly focused, yet curious about everything. I hope this audiobook will provide guidance for your imagination, that it will help you recognize all sorts of obstacles in order to circumvent them, or if need be, make them vanish, that it will reveal to you the surest way to bring your criminal intentions from inspiration to full-fledged execution to coup, and that along the way, it imparts what I have discovered about the benefits of passion, tenacity, intuition, misdirection, daily practice, secrets, mistakes, surprises, and believing in miracles. Most of all, I fervently wish it will remind you of the qualities hidden inside all of us, that we are rarely encouraged to recognize, but that are essential to make our dreams come true, to plan, design, and construct a wondrous life. I wish you the most adventurous journey, epic pursuit, and successful escape. Vehemently yours, Philippe Petit, 10 Rue Le Plat, Paris, October 6, 2012. Chapter 1. The Blank Page. In the print version of this audiobook that I'm looking at, I see that the page on the right is blank. If I turn past that page and turn back and this time look, the page will still be blank, but it will offer additional impressions. Looking draws me into observing. I observe, I explore. Each exploring step leaves a trace on the territory I claim as I progress. I explore, I conquer. The cliche of the anxious writer, pen frozen above a blank first page, never occurs to me. Instead, the blank page triggers wild anticipation. I'm on the edge of my seat like an impatient child. Please follow me. Invitation. With wondrous generosity, the blank page invites me. I am the graphic designer who divides space, who decides where to place text and illustrations in a meaningful and harmonious way, who already daydreams about the printing miracle ahead. I am the self-taught writer with polyglot passion, who scribes down little signs called letters, who groups them into words, gathers them into sentences, forms paragraphs, enough to fill the opening for my yet-to-be-authored first novel. Or is it my groundbreaking engineering theory? Or, why not, my definitive translation from Russian of Vladimir Vyatsky's Challenging Horses, the song that Mikhail Baryshnikov dances to in an empty Bolshoi theater in the film White Nights. I am the professional daydreamer who surrenders to the automatic wandering of his pen and covers the page with meaningless doodles, then turns them into recognizable shapes, animals, caricatures, monsters, castles in the sky. I am the frustrated movie director, my first film still inside my head, who draws a grid and fills each frame with rough-sketched action before he decides if the completed storyboard is a motion picture ready to be shot. I am the lecturer focused on problem solving who holds in my left hand a piece of paper and in my right a three-dimensional paper construction and challenges the audience. Can you make this into that without adding and gluing? And who then proceeds to demonstrate how the seemingly impossible feat can be done in 3 seconds if you relinquish one-dimensional thinking. I am the mischief master I've always been. That is, Lippo, my silent street-juggling character of 45 years, who breaks the rules by tearing the page into 3 strips, crumbles each into a ball, and juggles them. No, the pieces are too small and too light, the breeze too strong, the performance won't last beyond the initial 1-2-3 exchange, but certainly dedicated practice can change that. I am the rogue engineer who folds the blank sheet into a paper plane, sets it into the sky, and watches it disappear in the clouds or land softly at the feet of a child. I am the master of deception, the illusionist performing close-up magic for nearly 60 years, who walks through the page. A tour de force? Yes and no. If you are good with sharp scissors and supple-limbed, it's easy. You just have to know the exact cuts required. I am the passionate drawing artist I've always been, who suspends his charcoal for a moment above the large blank sheet of Fabriano before he traces lines and adds values that reveal a grand canyon at dusk with a high wire ready to be walked on and a sky of overlapping shades and shapes, portrait of an angry storm. Did I see the paper stock only as a surface? Or did I remember my private lessons with master pastelist Sam Zaffron, who shared with me his method of feeding the paper with graphite? Assault the paper. It is thick. Draw with depth. Scratch the sheet, with a nail, with a coin. Make the pigment penetrate the layers. Erase, then draw again. Fatigue the paper. Erode its skin. Erase, then draw again. As I force the drawing to emerge from the thick white sheet, I remember what is said about Michelangelo. The perfect sculpture of a rearing horse is hidden inside the block of marble the artist faces. Only after he has found the creature and admired its form can he begin to extract it, unscathed, to free it, one chisel blow at a time. Finding the horse is hard art, I think. Sculpting, it is, just hard work. Regardless of what I do with the blank page, what I give to it or steal from it, whether I abuse it, hijack it, or free it, consider it flat or give it volume, send it flying to heaven or to hell, I affix to it a hint of my mood, a trait of my character, a morsel of my existence, a part of me. Like Picasso, who by hand added Je suis le above the printed word cahier on his sketchbook cover, I declare, Je suis la page. I am the page. And what about you? How do you respond to the blank page? How does the blank page respond to you? Are you the page? A book of white. Oh, I forgot one option. What about doing nothing, just facing the blank page, as an expression of ultimate serenity, highest wisdom? That I cannot imagine. For me, inaction in the face of the blank page is not an option. Or if it occurs, it will not be because I didn't know what to do, but rather the opposite. I've got a million solutions to choose from. I know I'll never be the Tibetan monk seated in lotus position who contemplates the pile of blank pages set on the terrace of his Himalayan monastery. But wait, that image conjures back the aspiring filmmaker. I am the director and I want to try something. I ask my actor to throw the stack high in the air, where an icy breeze steals the pages and sends them tumbling one by one like sacred kites toward the faraway white peaks. Cut! Let's rewind in slow motion until all the sheets are back, neatly stacked on the terrace. Ah, a stack of blank pages. How appealing! Glued, stapled, or sewn, trimmed and bound, they become a book of white, what publishers call a dummy. Fill it with printed words, and it's a book to read. Passionately yours. If you think that I am now going to tell you how I am motivated to fill blank pages, you are wrong. There is no such thing as motivation in my world. I am not motivated to do what I do. As an artist, I am driven, I am compelled, I am thrust forward by a force so rooted inside me, so convincing that it seems futile to try to explain it, although it has a name. Passion. Passion is the mortar that holds my creative assemblies together. It is the motor of my actions. Because it is in perpetual motion, it has an impatient edge to it. It is urgent. And because it invites my arts to grow, it is essential. Propelled by such winds of passion, for whom do I create? Do I perform for myself or for an audience? My answer sits on both sides of that boundary. When I am in the park juggling inside my circle of chalk, I need to intrigue the passersby or else they will keep walking. During the performance, my comic character Lippo, who feeds on the crowd, reads the audience, ready to take advantage of their slightest reaction. And the instant I sense a hint of lethargy hovering above the crowd, I'll interrupt my juggling and launch a coup du théâtre sure to wake up everyone. I'll blow my whistle and set a tightrope between 2 trees. At the same time, in order to offer the most honest performance, I must be all alone. I must be prisoner of the fortress of my art. The true artistic impulse has nothing to do with pleasing the audience, or for that matter, with pleasing the impresario so you'll get more jobs or more money. That's not art. If you are an artist, you will want to create a giant wall around yourself, and inside that wall, to follow your honesty and your intuition. What the audience will see is a man or woman who is prisoner of his or her passion, and that is the most inspiring performance in the world. So there you have it, an answer full of contradictions. I have a subtle disregard for the audience, for whom I have the utmost attention and regard. And that brings us near my beloved fields of contradictions, which I'll invite you to explore with me soon enough. In the meantime, what should you be passionate about? Let's start there. The printing miracle. When I was 13, my curiosity for the graphic arts landed me an apprenticeship on Thursdays, at the time a day off from school in France, at Les Imprimeries de la Drôme et du Verdon, a reputable Parisian printing plant. I learned to set type by hand and to use the giant press, which had not progressed much since Gutenberg's era. For hours, I strained my left wrist to maintain a little rack, the composing stick, in the correct yet utterly unnatural position. In the tray before me, la casse, I found capital letters at the top, thus haute du casse, uppercase, and bas du casse, lowercase, letters at the bottom. For each line of text, I had to place on the stick the metal characters, mirror images of letters in relief, one by one upside down and running from right to left. When I finished composing a line, I placed it on a little zinc tray representing one page, and when my tray was full, I carefully transferred its contents to a bottomless frame, tightly imprisoning all its parts with steel expansion clamps. If I left any clamp a trifle loose, the entire work would shatter into hundreds of pieces all over the floor, to the amusement of the professionals around me. Although the repeated act of fishing tiny characters from the brimming casse brought tears to my eyes, I grew to appreciate that the result should not form a group of beautiful letters, but a beautiful group of letters. I became expert at recognizing fonts. Some had serifs, hairlines that extend their limbs elegantly and ease the reading. The limbs of the sans-serif family, by contrast, ended abruptly, yet proved more practical for certain compositions. Being surrounded by letters, I quite naturally invented my own font, and proudly employed it to send my pals handwritten missives that proved hard to decipher. At the end of the day, after the professional typesetters had finished their work, there was a short time when I was allowed to use the press before it was shut down for the night. Under close supervision, I placed my composed frames on the bed of the giant machine and set it in motion. Seconds later, the magic of printing revealed itself, and I was all smiles until I read what had been printed on the coarse sheet. I was not allowed to waste good stock. There, in all their indelibility, were my many typographic errors. And yet, how proud I was. Chapter 2. Chaos and Order. Passion is explosive. It knows no bounds. It can't be measured. I let it boil over to the point that sometimes I think and talk in all directions. Do you speak to yourself? I often do, silently. In keeping with our outlaw enterprise, why don't you eavesdrop on me as I interview myself? The Gallop of Chaos. So, how does the outlaw artist go about embarking on the perfect crime? What's the first step? What's the recipe? There is no recipe. Okay, what is the first step? My first step? Chaos. That's how I set my artistic crimes in motion. I toy with an idea until it becomes a fixation. The French have a name for it, idée fixe. It is an idea that you lodge in your brain with the understanding that it will refuse to leave. The word chaos is Greek and means that which gapes wide open. It's a beautiful word. I see a wide-open mouth hungry to swallow the world's knowledge. I do not fear chaos. I welcome it. Chaos for me cannot be still. I make it move. I gallop as fast as I can along its path to keep the pace of my excitement high. I must not lose the passion that drives me. In chaos, all is possible. Every incoming idea is welcomed with no regard for reality. Forget time, money, or reason. Embrace a brimming universe. Because if you start with rules, your creation will be stillborn. But ideas should not be left floating around aimlessly. I tie them to one another in no particular order with the rope of intuition. They are my prisoners. I know where to find them at all times. This gives me power and freedom. I can break rules. I can be daring. Where do those ideas come from? I have amassed considerable archival material throughout my life. Clippings, journals, specialized books, objects, iconographies on specific topics, posters, programs, random notes. I keep this material in innumerable files. Some topics sleep in a single folder, others fill an entire trunk. When I'm in search of ideas, I go through the files that I suspect hide gems or mysterious ingredients that may become part of my personal parkour. And, like Jean-Baptiste Grenouille, the master perfumer in Patrick Susskind's novel Perfume, I extract their essence. Can you give examples of such files? No, in this particular case, examples would be misleading, so let's have it all. Magic, street juggling, high wire walking, rock climbing, bullfighting, texts, languages, 18th century barn building, hand tools, pickpocket, lock picking, crime, cordage, knots, rigging, rue, Laplace, St. John the Divine, drawings, sacred geometry, gypsy, children's books, graphics, images, costumes, music. Hold on, some of this is obscure. What is rue Laplace? Wait! Photographs, chess, theater, travels, great restaurants, cooking, wines, engineering, alternative living systems, survival, bridges, blacksmithing, films, people, lectures, workshops, scale models, quizzes and puzzles, escapes, projects, and no's. This last one is a chest filled with projects I developed that, for whatever reason, were turned down. I will also go to the special shelf where I keep books that are most dear to me. I'll check for notes left in the margins and for press clippings I'm in the habit of slipping under the covers. And simultaneously. I understand, but how does all of this... Hold on! And simultaneously, with this frantic hunt, I welcome the avalanche of thoughts coming my way. However tiny, however absurd, anything that passes through my mind gets caught in my net. Organization? At this stage, I have no use for it. Why an avalanche? Why not a neat, manageable stack? Because from the start, I place myself in a state of extreme focus and urgency about the subject at hand. I am frenzied, you could say. Excess rules. Leaving something important behind would be a giant mistake. So I amass, until later, when the intellectual law of selection confiscates what's not essential. Pick two topics at random from your excessive list and use them to illustrate this process of intellectual industry that inhabits you. Sure, lockpicking and children's books. These days, unless you're a certified locksmith, if you're caught with burglar tools in your pocket, you go directly to jail, 3 years. Thus, a criminal lockpicker learns to make his own tools wherever he goes. Lockpicking, which I learned from poorly designed clandestine manuals, CIA pamphlets, and the Book of Trial and Error, is based on a simple fact. A system involving parts designed to function in harmony with one another can do so only if the system is imperfect, that is, if there is a minuscule space between the parts. Craftsmen call this mechanical tolerance. Without such a tolerance, a door would not open, a key would not turn in a lock, the world as we know it would not function. The art of lockpicking consists of exploiting mechanical tolerance by introducing tiny metal tools inside a locked mechanism and rearranging its moving parts until it opens. Why did the hot topic of lockpicking jump to mind? Joy. I take pleasure in finding imperfections in a system. I use them as tiny portals through which I sneak in, to explore, to understand, to create. To turn to my other topic, children's books. It's joy again. I delight in children's books, but mostly the ones I make. It started when I wanted to remind my daughter, Gypsy, that her traveling father was thinking lovingly about her from far away. I would tear striking images from magazines and mix them up with text and rough drawings I'd quickly make with thick markers. Minutes later, with the help of scissors and adhesive tape, a simple story was born and a one-of-a-kind album was assembled and put in the mail. As I kept making them, the stories became more interesting, the drawings more sophisticated, and the finished products more professional-looking. Soon I was giving children's books to friends for their kids' birthdays. That's why, to this day, I always keep my images portfolio full. And why do homemade children's books illustrate so well my creative process? Perhaps because it surprises me how an imposed starting point. Sometimes I ask the kids to provide a character, an animal, a color, a time for their story, or an existing series of images, the ones I tear from magazines, opens my imagination in an instant, leading to an utterly personal, original result. Okay, so these are elements in the avalanche, the frenzy and the excess. Now, what do you do with the whole chaotic pile? I allow it to slumber. I let its powder sprinkle my mind, which reminds me of Simon Verity, the master stone carver who for years could be seen with stone dust in his hair, hitting his chisel with his mallet, tuck, 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 against the blocks of the portal of paradise at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine. By the end of the day, his hair had turned handsomely gray, sprinkled with minuscule particles of limestone. The next morning, he came to work with the powder still clinging to his head, wearing it all day like a crown, smiling like a prince. Then I take a break. For example, thinking about this book, I'll play a while with the concept of its cover. Although I'm aware it is the graphic designer, not the author who designs the cover, this fooling around is far from pointless. It adds lines to the stitchboard of my ongoing creative network. It provides new mental connections that will surface, somewhere, someday, book or no book, when I wake them up. I'm fond of triggers. After all, I'm the person who ordered a magnificent door handle from a blacksmith, and upon receiving it declared, "Now that I have a way to open the door, all I need to do is build a barn around it." Oh, and to deal with what you call the chaotic pile, I now start a fresh filing container dedicated to the project, which will stand open on my desk until completion of the work. With separate indexed folders? Now you're getting it! Yes, with separate indexed folders, color-coded of course, that cover all aspects of the endeavor I am building, from excavation to opening celebration. I'll keep old drafts in the back of the container, and in the front, I'll have a large open envelope labeled a classé to file, where I'll throw things that I will sort out when I feel like it.
How long do you stay with chaos?
Until order emerges, which it does at its own pace. And the space between chaos.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.